Okay, this series of lectures, we're going to be talking about the long-run effects of the money supply. So the money supply is determined by the Federal Reserve or other central bank in a modern economy. In a pre-modern economy, if we had something like the gold standard, it would be determined by how much gold has been discovered and mined recently, so that in the aftermath of something like a gold rush, we would have an increase in the money supply. We're also going to talk about money demand, and that's what I'm going to concentrate on in this video segment. And of course, when we talk about money demand, you may say, my demand for money is extremely high. I demand lots of money, please. What we're really talking about here is the demand for liquid assets instead of illiquid assets. So if you sort of look at it, how do truly wealthy people hold most of their assets? They hold most of their assets not as money in the checking account, but rather as stocks and bonds and that sort of thing. So the key thing, of course, is that these illiquid assets have a higher rate of return. So that might be stocks or bonds or real estate, maybe a certificate of deposit or something like that. Liquid assets have a low rate of return, but of course, you need them to engage in transactions. Notice that the more real transactions I engage in, the more gallons of milk I buy every month, means a higher demand for money. I'll need more money in my checking account to get through the month if I have a sort of high level of earning and high level of spending than someone who has a lower level of earning and spending. So say, for instance, we might find that maybe people typically keep 1 or 2 months worth of money in their checking account. And then anything over that, they can go ahead and put in a savings account or some kind of investment. So more real transactions means a higher demand for money. So you need more of that liquid money to get through all of your transactions. Another thing to notice out there is that when the price level is higher, when that milk costs more, or if there's inflation and all prices in the economy go up, a higher price level also means a higher demand for money. On the other side of it, some forms of financial technology may allow us to get through our transactions with less money. So if I have something like bank overdraft protection, then my incentive to keep a lot of money in my checking account is smaller, and that's going to impact my demand for money. So financial technology may enable me to conserve on money, or things like interest rates, higher interest rates, are going to typically decrease the demand for money, because I don't want to keep money in the checking account where it earns a very low interest rate, if any at all, if I can earn, 5 or 10% by putting it into a certificate of deposit. So these two things tend to decrease the demand for money. We're going to go ahead and formalize all this in a formula. And that formula is MV equals PY. So M times V equals P times Y. This M is our money demand. This P is the price level, something like the CPI, or the GDP deflator. This Y here is real GDP. And this V here is what we call the velocity of money, which I've always loved as a phrase. So the velocity of money, the idea here is, how many times does money change hands in a given year, or how many transactions per year can a dollar facilitate or make happen? And we'll see if I can spell facilitate. I think that's right. Maybe there's two L's. So, essentially, we're predicting that if the price level goes up, you want to demand more money. If the real volume of transactions goes up, you want to demand more money. If the number of transactions per year that money can accomplish goes up, then to keep everything equal, the amount of money that you want to demand would go down. So this is what's known as the quantity equation for money demand. This being algebra, we can manipulate this in a couple of different ways. We can go ahead and isolate the demand for money on one side here. So here we predict money demand if we know what the price level is, know what GDP is, and know what this velocity of money is. Or we could, for instance, get to a prediction that the price level equals MV over Y. So that's if we take both sides here, divide by Y, it cancels out over here, and we get a Y on the bottom of the fraction over there. So this is, if we're going to think about money demand, and this one here is useful for predicting the price level, if we know the other three variables. And we'll go ahead and stop there and talk about a supply and demand model for money.